Hello and welcome to this PalmSense video. Today I would like to talk about compliance voltage, because if you meet the compliance voltage, you want to know that you did. First, let's have a look at our usual 3-electrode cell with a working counter and reference electrode, where, well, usually, the current is flowing between the working and counter electrode to close our circuit. As a result, often the chemical environment of both of these electrodes changes. So, as a reference point, we usually use a third electrode, which is the reference electrode. It's a current-free electrode, so it keeps a constant potential throughout our whole measurement. So far, I think most electrochemists can tell you exactly that, and they know the potentiostat very well. There's one thing that many people don't pay attention to or are not constantly aware of, that is, there is a potential between the working electrode and the counter electrode to drive exactly that current. That potential is adjusted so the current can flow that will guarantee the potential between the working and reference electrode. That potential that we apply between the counter and working electrode is the cell voltage or cell potential. In a two-electrode system, the applied potential and the cell voltage or cell potential will be the same. In our three-electrode system, the potentiostat chooses this potential between the working and counter-electrode for you. The maximum voltage that you can have in this situation, that is the compliance voltage. So the compliance voltage is the maximum potential you can have between working and counter-electrode. This potential and how it works has a few implications that I would like to have a look at right now, just to have a look at what happens at your counter electrode. I just have here a CV of a platinum electrode in sulfuric acid. Platinum is a very popular material for counter electrodes, so this is why I've chosen that one. And on the right side at the bottom, you will see now just a very common CV, just a reversible redox couple. Now we want to know what's happening at our counter electrode. Let's go with the extreme. So first with the highest anodic current that we have, which is, just for the sake of this example, 1 milliampere, while the working electrode is at 0.3 volts. What's now happening at the counter electrode? The counter electrode has to deliver now 1 milliampere, but in the opposing direction. So minus 1 milliampere. So the counter electrode starts at its OCP, which is around at 600 millivolts, and the current is of course zero. Then the potentiostat moves the potential of the counter electrode until it reaches minus 1 milliampere. So in that case, it means towards more cathodic potentials, and we end up at hydrogen evolution potentials. Now we have our minus 1 milliampere, we are at around minus 180 millivolts, which means our cell voltage, so the difference between the counter and working electrode, is 480 millivolts. If we're now going to the other extreme, which is our cathodic peak, there we have minus 1 milliampere at around 200 millivolts. And you guessed it already, we again need a current in the other direction, so plus 1 milliampere. So here we have our arrow that represents the 1 milliampere, and now the potentiostat is moving again our potential till we reach the plus 1 milliampere that we have to keep the potential at our working electrode. That would mean we end up at 1.55 volts, and as we are at 200 millivolts on our working electrode, we have a cell potential of 1.35 volts. Okay, now you have an idea what's happening at your counter electrode while you're running your measurement at your working electrode. Now let's look at the implications and how we get in trouble with the compliance voltage, which again is the highest potential difference you can have between working and counter electrode. So let's say you choose a too small counter electrode for actually the current that is flowing through your working electrode. Whoop. So now we have less current because we have a smaller surface area. We now would need to move our potential to even more cathodic potentials. And eventually, we will meet some form of diffusion limit, right? So where increasing the potential will not lead to a higher current. Maybe we even reach the compliance voltage, so the maximum potential we could apply before we get into that very cathodic potential region where we would get this current. And that would be not great. And it can even be worse depending on what electrode material you choose. So you should be careful when you choose, for example, carbon as a counter electrode because it requires an even more higher cell voltage because platinum actually is a good catalyst for water splitting. How does that look in your measurements? Well, in a CV, often you see a very sharp peak and suddenly often a rather noisy curve happening there. In a DPV, it looks different. There, suddenly your current drops to zero. Why is that? Well, you reach the compliance voltage, so you're actually applying a constant voltage instead of the pulse profile that you thought you would apply. So your forward and your reverse current would be the same, and as a result, the plotted current, which is the difference of both of these currents, is zero. Right, okay. Maybe this is a bit abstract. Let's have a quick look at PSTrace at a measurement that I did where I run into the compliance voltage. Okay, so this is my measurement. This is a CV with a suspicious sharp peak here and then some ziggy-zaggy curves. And I wonder, did I run into my compliance voltage? An easy way to find out is if you have one of our newer devices like the PalmSense 4, the Emstead 4, or one of the sensor devices, you can just click on record additional data and choose to record the cell potential. And this you need to do before the measurement, and then during the measurement you will record the cell potential. So when I now also put in the same graph the cell potential, you see that at the same point where I have this very sharp peak, I get suddenly a flat line. I've reached the maximum cell potential that I can apply. Why does now the curve look this way? Well, this we can better see in a plot of the current and the cell potential versus time. So here in this plot, where magenta is our current, we see that a sudden sharp peak and the following shape of the curve is actually the result of such a current decay over time, like Cottrell behavior. And this is actually Cottrell behavior because we do apply a constant potential instead of the sweep that we thought that we are applying. Then the current is decaying, and when we plot the same thing then versus the applied potential or the potential that we thought that we would be applying, it looks very different and it's kind of hard to recognize. So tips are plot it maybe versus time and record your cell voltage. If you do encounter the problem that you run into the compliance voltage, there are a few measures that can help you to avoid that. You can try to reduce the current at your working electrode. You can try to have a bigger counter electrode, so you have at the same potential a higher current at your counter electrode. Or you can also try to design a different reaction for your counter electrode. Maybe change to a silver electrode, then you would oxidize or reduce the silver electrode itself. So, this is everything that I wanted to talk about in this video. I hope you found it helpful and consider subscribing to us on YouTube or following us on LinkedIn. So, thanks for watching and have a great day.